Ladies and gentlemen, family and friends, thank you all for joining us here once again for Inside the Music, where we are here with this episode's guest, Art Sherrod Jr. You know how we do it.
Ladies and gentlemen, this afternoon, I'd like to introduce one of my favorite saxophonists, great musician, has worked with a lot of people. His name is Art Sherrod Jr. And Art, tell us what we want to know. How did you get started and why did you pick out saxophone? Because I do know for a start, you didn't start with a saxophone.
Yes, yes. So, well, first of all, thank you for having me. You know, the saxophone was not my first choice of instruments. When I started playing around the age of 13 in the middle school band. And so just like any other boy, you want to bang around and bang on stuff. So I wanted to be a drummer, actually, originally. And because of the work schedule of my mother and my father, my mom went to work at midnight. My dad went to work at 7 a.m. They weren't having a bunch of noise. So I then wanted to play the trumpet. And my aunt, who was a music teacher, had convinced my mother that the trumpet would push my teeth in. So I ended up passing on the trumpet. And around that time, when you're 13 or so, you start to notice that boys and girls don't look the same. And so you start getting into girls. And I was like, man, I wonder what instrument would the girls like. And so that ended up being the saxophone. And so that's what I ended up landing on. And actually, I loved it from the moment I started playing it. So that's kind of the backstory on me and the saxophone.
Well, at a young age, being that you got into saxophone, who were some of the people that you listened to at an early age that you decided, yeah, this is what I want to do?
Well, I started playing when I was in the 80s. So that was around the time we were hearing a lot of Grover Washington Jr., listening to some George Howard, Kirk Whalum, Gerald Albright, Kim Waters, David Sanborn. Those were people that were early influences on me because that was just kind of the age and time that I grew up in. So I didn't discover, the Charlie Parkers and the John Coltranes and Miles Davises until, a little later in the journey.
And those are the guys, see, I started out with, because originally, there used to be a program in New York called William B. Williams Make Believe Ballroom. And on there, you had nothing but a lot of music. And the stuff that I was listening to was Charlie Bird Parker, Clifford Brown, Lester Young, Billie Holiday. So it was easy to slide into, hey, that's what I want to do because I liked what I was hearing from them.
Right. Yeah, and that was a great time. I mean, though everyone you named there, they really laid the foundation for us in jazz.
Yeah, because when you look at it, you had a lot of saxophone players back then. Besides them, training and everything, you had Eric Dolphy, you had Johnny Hodges, if you go into saxophone, we both know Duke Ellington had a lot of great saxophonists in his band.
Indeed, man.
So it was easy. Gene Ammons, Wayne Shorter, you had a lot of people that you could actually listen to. And the funny thing was, Coltrane happened to be my mentor. So I practiced and did a lot of things with him. And as you and I discussed, you play a soprano saxophone.
Right.
And I told you, I can't stand the sound of that thing. I didn't like it when Coltrane played it. He played "These Are My Favorite Things," and I wanted to wait until he put it down and went to go get his tenor and just take the thing and snap it in half. I could not. But you were the first person I heard play that thing, and I went, damn, that's nice. I like that, you know? But and the funny thing is, you played with a lot of well-known vocalists. And the funny thing is, that's originally how I heard you. When I was running a record label out of Arizona, one of the guys that I was going to sign, who's a friend of yours, which is Robert G.
Yeah.
And Robert gave me a group of his music, and I'm playing his music, and he put on a track that you were on. And I said to him, yo, Rob, who's that? And he went, what do you mean? Who's the saxophonist behind you? And he said to me, oh, that's Art. And I said, okay, that's good. Art who? And he said, oh, that's Art Sherrod Jr. I said, oh, okay, cool. He's like, in fact, him and I are going to be doing some stuff that together we're going to do later. And that's when I said, oh, I got to find out about him because he's got to go on my new list.
There we go. You know?
And the funny thing was, checking you out, I see that you have played with a lot of well-known vocalists.
Yeah. I have.
You did stuff with Will.
Yeah. Will, with Michael Henderson, Gene Karn, you know, one of my favorites, Phil Perry.
Yeah, that's my favorite guy. Him and my girl, Miss Leakes.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Macy.
Macy, yeah. I love her.
She's a sweetie. And, you know, I got the chance to play with Cuba Gooding Sr. And the main ingredient was definitely a treat. And, you know, just a lot of different vocalists, from Howard Hewitt to Shantae Moore to Kenny Lattimore. So a lot of people. I enjoy it because the saxophone, tonally, it's the closest thing you're going to get to a voice. And yeah. So I like to think of myself as an extension of a voice. So that's why I just enjoy working with vocal. I mean, I enjoy working with, you know, instrumentalists as well, but vocalists are something special.
And that's a difficult thing because I know for a fact there are a lot of musicians that can't play with a vocalist.
Yeah, you know, it's funny, you know, and I think all of us instrumentalists at some point get smacked on the hand a little bit. I remember working with Gary Taylor, and that was kind of my smack on the hand because sometimes if you're not careful, you'll run right into the vocalist.
Yep.
And so comping a vocalist is important. You got to learn how to play and kind of stay out of their way, but still be present. And I remember us rehearsing and he's like, Hey man, you can't be stepping all on me, you know? And I thought, oops, my bad. You know, you learn your lesson real fast, but it was a good lesson because it makes me a little bit more even now it makes me more cognizant of what's going on around me and where that vocal is going.
Yeah.
Yeah, because one of the things I remember is I remember early on, Coltrane said he'd never play with a vocalist because he just could not fathom himself playing with a vocalist because they would not match. Yet, the one vocalist he did was Johnny Hartman.
Johnny Hartman, one of my favorite records.
Cannonball Adderley was the same thing. The one vocalist that he always would play with and for, Nancy Wilson.
Yeah.
But they only had one vocalist that they could work with.
Right.
Well, see, like Art was saying earlier, the saxophone is the closest thing to a lead vocal, male or female. Your baritone sax gives you your bass lead vocal to your second tenor. Your tenor solo takes your regular range, and your alto and soprano go in just like the choir, you know. And most of the time, the melody structures, unless the individual is going like really abstract, the melody structures are very much the same as a vocalist, you know.
Oh, I know. I played saxophone, so I know exactly. And that was one thing I could not do. I could not play with a vocalist. I just couldn't.
Yeah, it's difficult. I mean, but you learn how to do it. And, you know, I grew up singing in the choir. So by doing that, I kind of had a understanding of kind of where the vocals go and the movements. And, you know, so it helps me a lot in just playing around them opposed to playing over top of them.
Well, here's a question. Why did you choose those two particular saxophones? Because all saxophone players have certain saxes that they will play and certain ones they won't play. I would not play a baritone sax and I would not play a soprano. I had an alto I played tenor. And the funny thing was, everybody always questioned me. I had a C melody. And everybody always asked, why in the devil would you play a C melody saxophone?
Right, right.
Because it had a different sound.
Yeah. You know, very early on in my career, you would see me play a lot of soprano and alto. And then it transitioned to, it wasn't that I didn't have a tenor, but I couldn't find my voice on tenor. And so it really wasn't up until probably about 6-7 years ago that I really started playing tenor more and more as a lead instrument because I found my voice. And so I don't play as much soprano now, but at that time, that's kind of how I heard things, you know, in that soprano alto range. And then I guess as we get older, we start to hear things a little different. And our sound matures. So now I play a lot more tenor saxophone. So, and you know, the tenor saxophone I absolutely love. And I play some baritone too. So all of those are things that I guess our ears mature to.
Yeah, you know, because... I play keys, okay? I used to play sax when I was in junior high school, but wintertime at tenor sax, the snow was about 8 inches higher than the bottom of my saxophone case.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so that tenor saxophone, the alto was already gone.
Yeah.
Well, the only thing that was left was the tenor, you know, and... I only drug it through 2 winters, man. And but on the keys, that's one of the main patches. I got a pretty good patch. I've had it scrutinized by quite a few saxophonists.
Right. You know?
But that's a go-to instrument for me. I mean, like that's the, like you said, what instrument do the chicks really?
Yeah,
it's the saxophone. They like guitar players. Keyboard players, we get stuck in the back because we got that big. What you laughing at? we got 3-4 keyboards. We working hard all night long, and y'all step out in the spotlight and do your thing, and everybody fake. You like the lead vocalist?
Yeah, man. Yeah, but you know that those instruments. I tell you, the saxophone. I'm so glad that I did choose it, or it chose me. And man, like I said, you know, as my ears get a little bit, continue to mature, you know, I've been playing more tenor and alto than anything else. But I'm getting ready to add my baritone into my set, not to play a bunch of songs, but to add it into my set. You know, because I've also gotten into this thing where I want to do at least a song in my set as a tribute to jazz legends. And so I recently added In a Sentimental Mood, where we were talking about Duke Ellington. And so I typically play that on tenor. I'm thinking about bringing out my Barry and doing that song on baritone saxophone during my show. So it's just amazing the path you go from playing a lot of soprano and alto. Now I'm playing more tenor and some alto, and now I'm bringing in my Barry, you know. And then I play a little bit of flute also, just to keep it interesting.
See, I had a lot of saxophone players around me. That was the thing. Being mentored by Coltrane, Coltrane had a lot of people that went to him, that he drew in, that wanted to learn how he played. So I had a lot of cats around me that I really enjoyed. One of them was Pharoah Sanders. I love Pharoah Sanders. Man, and what he played, I mean, I actually love. But the funny thing was, my sister sang with Oscar Peterson's trio. Ooh, she wound up marrying, guess who? Stanley Turrentine. You know, and I used to get beat up because my thing was, I need to go in that case and get that saxophone out of there, because his sounds a whole lot better than the one that I got. And it was like, what are you doing, bro? I'm trying to get look at the saxophone, you know, to compare it to mine, you know. And back in those days, those guys did not buy a cheap saxophone. They were playing Selmers and Combs.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
And I asked the cat the other day, I said, well, I used to play saxophone. And he said, when? And I said, when I played saxophone, it was back in the early 60s. Mm-hmm. I said, my parents bought the sax for me. And he said, really? I said, yeah. I said, I'd even think about going. I said, I haven't played since probably the late 70s, I said, but, you know, I was kind of thinking maybe I'd go and buy one. I said, what do they run? And he looked at me and said, they run about $8,000. And I started laughing, and I said to him, you're kidding, right? And he's like, no, I'm not kidding. Why? I said, because my mother and father paid $300 for that damn, and I had a Selma. I said, it cost $300. He said, You can't go to a pawn shop and get one for $300.
No, you're not a good one. If you're gonna sell one, man, yeah, you're gonna be up. That's you know, they're like the Mercedes Benz, the Rolls Royces of instruments. You know, their value, it's high. You know, it's very high. People want them. You know, those Mark Sixes. That's the golden ticket right there.
Yeah. Because it was funny, I actually told him, because I actually asked him what kind of reed he used, because I told him when I first started, I remember when they first came out with the plastic reeds. Uh-huh. And the old reed, the wooden reeds had a number stamped on it, whether it was a 2 or 3 or whatever. And they couldn't do that with the plastic ones. So they actually valued what it was by color, whether it was a blue or red or whatever.
Oh, wow.
And he's like, nah, man, they don't do that no more. Because I told him, I said, I had a plastic mouthpiece and I changed to a metal one. And he said, yeah, well, you need to find out how much those mouthpieces cost now. Because I said, mouthpieces were $25 back then. And he started laughing. He said, you can forget that. You're not going to find a mouthpiece anyplace. And especially a metal one, no way.
No, you definitely won't do that. And no. No way.
No way, huh?
Mouthpieces I'm playing on, you know, you know, I have one that's like a $600-$700 mouthpiece, you know.
For a mouthpiece?
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah. So, you know, if you get metal, you know, you're going to be paying $600-$700 for a mouthpiece. You know, for hard rubber, you could be paying $200-$400 for a hard rubber. And look, now, I'm fortunate that I have an endorsement with Theo on it. But yeah, they get expensive, but you know, the design in them, that's where the value is. The material that they make them, that they use to make them, and then the design that gives you that, what, you know, kind of more the flavor that you're looking for, whether it's a dark open, dark closed, you know, bright, yeah, bright, edgy. So, you know, they put a lot of craftsmanship into making these mouthpieces now, and the machinery they use is second to none.
So, Art, you say you got an endorsement right now? Whose mouthpieces are you using?
I use exclusively, I use Theo Wanning mouthpieces. It's Theo Wanne. And those mouthpieces are phenomenal. You know, I've been with Theo for 10 years. Been with him for a while, and he makes some great mouthpieces. A lot of artists that you'll see on the scene are using them, and you know, they're just great pieces.
Now, do you tell them what kind of mouthpiece you need, or do you design a mouthpiece and they build it for you, or what?
Well, a lot of times what happens is they'll have a mouthpiece that sounds kind of, I tell them what I'm looking for. You know, I need something that's going to be bright. It's going to be open here and it's going to have a little edge to it, but I don't want to be too bright. And so then based upon what they already have, because they have a slew of mouthpiece, different types of mouthpieces. So then they can then customize, you know, they have all my numbers and stuff like that. So they're able to go in and do some custom stuff for me, you know, if I need it. Yeah.
You know, we didn't have that back in the day. Back in the day was walk in the store and go, I want that one.
Right, right. And if you had a Selma C-Star or a AutoLink or something like that, you had something.
That's exactly what I had.
Yeah, man. So, yeah, but they, like I said, the mouthpiece technology is incredible. You know, the ligatures from the reeds, even to the horns, you know, everything is, it's different now. You know, like I said, the Selmers, they're just expensive horns that I think they will always be, just based upon their history. You know, I have an endorsement with Cannonball saxophones, not to be construed with the Cannonball Adderley, but the Cannonball is more of a medieval type of signature. So, but Cannonball saxophones are in Salt Lake City, Utah, which my good friend Gerald Albright actually introduced me to them. And I've been playing their horns definitely for about 10, 12 years. And I love them. I mean, all of my horns, I endorse the Raven model saxophone. So I have a Raven model soprano, alto, tenor, and baritone.
And here's a question for you. You say, I know you play alto, and I've seen the alto you play. Mm-hmm. They also have a curved soprano that's shaped just like the alto, and it has a different sound than just the elongated one that's like the clarinet.
That's true. So I also have a curved one. So I typically use that one when I record. And the reason why is because you mic it very similar to how you mic an alto or a tenor or any other instrument. When you deal with the straight soprano, it's a little bit more difficult to mic it in the right place. Because like you said, it's a tough instrument to hear. If you don't mic it correctly, it'll split your head wide open. You know, so, you know, I like playing the curved soprano because it also, from a feel standpoint, it feels almost like I'm playing an alto or a tenor to some degree.
Why is it that very few saxophonists actually play that particular one, the curved one, as opposed to using the straight one?
Me personally, it's more of an aesthetic thing. You know, I'm 6 feet tall and I didn't want to, you know, it looks a little weird.
Like a toy.
Curved. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I've heard a lot of cats say, look like a toy.
Yeah, you know, I remember years ago playing in this club and I could hear the people to the front row was real close to me. They're like, oh, look at him playing the little saxophone. I was like, okay, I can't do that anymore.
Well, and the funny thing is, I remember being, I think I must have been about four, and I actually was given a toy saxophone, just like the curved soprano. I actually had one of those as a toy. And the first time I actually saw a guy play one, I actually thought when he took it out of the case, I said, oh, he's getting ready to prank somebody because that's a toy. But when he started playing it, I was like, that ain't nobody's toy. That's an actual saxophone. But it looked exactly like that toy that I had been given.
Yeah. Yeah. They do look like a toy. I will say that. But and they sound great. But like I said, for me, most of the time you see me playing live, it'll be with the straight. And actually, I play an arc soprano. So it's straight. And then at the very end, it bends. So reason for that little bend is it warms up the sound. So it's just nasally. So that's the one that I actually use live.
And in the studio, I like you were saying earlier, I found that to be a major difference between the curved one and the straight one. Because it's a lot easier to get a good recording on the curved one, where the straight one, some notes will get just right, brassy, you know.
Yeah, you almost have to mic it. You almost have to put a mic middle of it and then one off of the bell so you can catch all of that high end. But all the sweetness of a straight soprano is right there in the middle. That's really where all that's the sweetness is on that horn. But it's tough to record. So, you know, I bail out and just use the soprano or the curve when I can.
So what you doing any projects lately, Art? What you working on?
Well, I just I finished up a record in February, and it was a record that I hadn't planned on even doing because I started working on my next record. I actually started probably about a year and a half ago, you know, before COVID or what have you. And, you know, COVID hits, and then toward the latter part of last year, a good buddy of mine, who's a phenomenal drummer and producer, he and I had talked about, I wanted to do like a love songs record. And so he's like, look, man, everybody's at home. So why don't we go ahead and make this record? And so I ended up doing a record called The Art of Love. Actually, I think I have one here. Yeah, I just happen to have one here. So I ended up doing this one. It's called The Art of Love. And so I went and recorded a bunch of love songs, but I didn't write anything on this record. I wanted it to be just that, love songs that you could recognize. So I went and I recorded Pretty Brown Eyes, Mint Condition. You know, I Get Lonely, Janet Jackson, Always and Forever. We all know that song. And Between the Sheets and Thinking Out Loud, if Only You Knew, and Lady in My Life, I Can't Make You Love Me, Bonnie Raitt song. So, you know, it was a record that I had a lot of fun, but it wasn't planned. It was one that just kind of came out of COVID, and I released it in February. And I'm just kind of holding off on the other record. It's pretty much finished, but I think I'll just wait until 2022. You know, I had thought that no one was recording during COVID, but I was wrong. I mean, everybody was recording during COVID. So it's a lot of music just kind of out there and everybody's kind of bumping around. So I said, you know what? I'll just wait. I'm in no hurry. And like I said, this record has actually done more, done way better than I had anticipated. I actually had not really, you know, I just did it because, you know, I wanted to have a love songs record. And it, you know, people have really gravitated toward it.
So are we getting ready? What are we getting ready to play?
We're getting ready to play the song that he just titled, which was a tune done by Patti LaBelle. And at one time was actually done by Patti and Luther as a duet. Mm-hmm. If only you knew.
Okay, well, TC, take it away, man.
We have here for you by Art Sherrod Jr., If You Only Knew.
I must have rehearsed.
gentlemen, that was If You Only Knew by Art Sherrod Jr. We already hear the brothers already talking about the song on the couch. Let's join them back on Inside the Music.
As far as a love song, you kind of had the idea of doing love songs, which was really good for the simple reason that I was fighting with a group of writers that I knew and musicians. And I kept saying, I got a project that we need to do and it will last forever.
Right.
And they looked at me and said, yeah, right. What the hell is that? And I said, I want to do a album called The Wedding Book. And they looked at me and said, The Wedding Book?
He already took one of my songs from me to put on The Wedding Book. Took it. Took it.
Now that I have so many writers around me and musicians, and they go, oh, I'm doing this song because this is a love song and I want it. And I said, first of all, when anybody's getting married, first thing they do is if they don't have a musical history, they're going to a DJ going, yo, we need a song to dance after the wedding. We getting engaged. I need to play a song that I could get down on my knee and pop the ring out for her. And that's what, when I got ready to do it, they said, and I wrote out a list. And the DJ said, yo, where you get? I said, listen, I worked for record companies. I know exactly. And I said, my man Luther got a whole hoop of songs everybody used. I don't care how old and how long ago those songs were done. They still playing them. Always and forever and stuff like that. And I said, so it's not a big deal.
Right.
So the bottom line is, that's what I said. So he came up with a song titled, I Do.
Yeah, but wait a minute. This song was actually written when Always and Forever came out. That's how long ago I wrote it. But the group that I was working with broke up. The vocals were never right. Then it got dated. It was still a good song, but it just got dated. You know, everybody heard it. They still, oh, that's so pretty. But it was, I couldn't stand it. I had been hearing it for the last 40 years. Right.
Right.
So recently, it's been decades. You know, you have one of those dreams.
Right.
You know, I haven't done it in decades. I had a dream. I heard the whole song. I woke up. I couldn't remember any of it. About 3-4 days later, I was sitting there and it all came at one time. You know, I let Don hear it. Yeah, this is going on the wedding book.
I even made up artwork for it.
Oh, I haven't seen the artwork yet.
He hasn't seen the artwork, but I already have the artwork made up. And it's two individuals, and they're just drawings of two individuals very close to each other. And in between their lips, it says, I do. And at the bottom of it, it says, song from The Wedding Book.
Ah, there you go.
Because after they hear that, the next thing will come, well, that song is I Do, and it's from The Wedding Book. The rest of the songs?
Where's the book at?
Where is the rest of the songs that complete this wedding book?
He pimping me.
and just like he said, he wrote it way back then and it was dated. Well, if you go back and listen to all these songs they're pulling out for weddings and stuff like that, and all of the parties and everything after, they're all dated because that's when substantial music was written.
Love songs.
That's when writers had content to put in music.
Right.
So quite naturally, that's what they picked.
You know, they were telling stories back then. You know, the love songs were really about their lives or their experiences, the things that they've really seen. So, yeah. So that's why, you know, like when you hear Marvin Gaye's song, they will never go out of style because, you know, he's talking about life during that time. You know, it wasn't some fantasy. you know, talking about we all have all these Bentleys and all that stuff will go away, man. But he's talking about real life.
Funny thing is, it was funny because my wife is 17 years younger than I am. So I'll play stuff and she'll go, "What is that? I never heard that before." And is that what you guys played for music back then? And what were the things you said to women? And I said, everything that we said to girls in school that we wanted to connect with, I said, we took out of a song by somebody else. I said, my favorite album was the album by the Flamingos that had "I Only Have Eyes for You."
Oh my goodness.
Hey baby, don't worry about it. Yeah, I see her, but listen, don't even worry about her. I only got eyes for you, baby. So you ain't gotta worry about it. I told her everything. We had no rap. Our rap came out of everything that was recorded.
Some of y'all.
But you ain't had no rap.
Some of y'all did.
No, you ain't had no rap. Your rap was, "Hey baby, I play keyboard."
Some of y'all didn't have a rap.
Yeah, that was your rap. "Hey baby, I play keyboard."
Oh man, that's funny.
Some of y'all didn't have a rap. Yeah.
Oh man.
Out there repeat Curtis Mayfield.
No, this was before Curtis. This was before Curtis. We going back to somebody like Harry Fuqua, okay? Wow. We going back to him and the Moon Glows and stuff and Eldorados and stuff like that. You know, Wind and those songs, we talk about way back, even as far back as going into my guy who actually had a group of them. No, not Fred. This was after Fred. This was after Fred, but before the Jetsons. And that's when he had the Ink Spots.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, wow. Wow.
But you know, when you were talking about old love songs, one that I've been thinking about doing was Curtis Mayfield's "You're Prettier Than All the World." I'm so proud.
Yeah, I'm so proud of you.
Yeah, that was a bad one. When you were going down the songs, I'm like, yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah, you know, and there's so many. You know, I didn't want to capture, you know, they to me, there are no real like current day love songs. So like we were saying, so I wanted to get stuff that captured love back in the day, and then and touched on some stuff that they've done recently, but yeah, they don't make love songs like they used to.
You did a love song on your album.
Which
one by who was it? Anthony Hamilton and Jill Scott.
Oh, you're talking about "So in Love"?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I did that.
I love that song. Yeah.
Back to Business Project. Yeah.
I love that song, and I like the way you did that. You know, there aren't many. That's the problem. There are a few. They're just so far and few and in between.
That's true.
And they get run over by all the stuff masquerading as a supposed love song.
That's true. That's true.
So that, you know, I listened to a lot of those songs in that album that you did. And that was my thing. They were all done extremely well. And they were all done with a certain vibrance to the song itself. So it gave it what I always tell a lot of writers and stuff, it gives it legs. And right. They go, "What does that mean?" And I says, it gives it a type of longevity. Because one of the things I always found is a lot of musicians don't like to use strings in their music. But I've always found that the most successful albums that artists had always had strings in.
Strings are not a very easy instrument to implement. Strings have to be played properly, or they're not strings. They're a violin patch, which is often what you end up hearing. And so a lot of cats don't know, that's when it comes into orchestration and arrangement.
Oh, absolutely. Because they're impressive. I mean, they strings can create all kinds of moods, you know, and all kinds of expressions. So when they're played properly, man, they can make you cry. They can make you happy. They can make you mad.
Exactly. You
know, all of those things. Yeah.
I cut a track just recently, and two of my friends were in town, two of the cats from the Ohio players, Billy Beck, the keyboard player, and Rick Ward, the guitar player. They were in town, so they stayed, they spent the night. So we got up the next morning, and Rick dropped a nice, really nice guitar part. Billy got on and he played this organ part that was so subtle that it immediately disappeared in the track. It was like it was the first thing that was played. It was so subtle. And then he put a string part on it, and I watched what he was playing with the string part. And the simplicity of the complex, it like you said, it's when played properly, it will elevate. But when not played properly, it's in the way.
Exactly. Distraction. Yeah. No. Absolutely.
And a lot of cats don't know how to use it, so that's the reason. Like, that's a sound that you hear very seldom nowadays. It's not part of the, it's not part of the landscape of the music that we're hearing today.
Mm-hmm. It's just that when I did it and I do it, I've had a lot of musicians say things like, "You produce stuff like a white boy."
Huh.
And I tell them, yeah, you're right. Because basically, that string part and all of that, I learned from cats like Nelson Riddle, Oliver Nelson.
That analogy, that's the reason I started working in the box. That's the reason I started producing using computers. Because black cats couldn't afford strings. That's what it was. Black cats could not afford orchestration.
Yeah.
So all the black music for a long time, unless you get picked up with a major label, it was just a rhythm section with horns at best, you know? Mm-hmm. And so for me as a writer producer, I always heard the arrangements, the orchestration, you know? So I had to go into the computer to be able to get what was in my head out, because I couldn't afford to get a 75-piece string section.
In prices, yeah.
Right, because one violin does not make a string section.
I basically learned a lot of that from my uncle. And he recorded, he was the one that produced and recorded Clifford Brown with strings, Betty Carter with strings. He did all of that stuff.
But man, this has been a great conversation, man.
Absolutely.
I hate to wrap it up. It's like we talked about a lot of stuff and didn't talk about nothing almost.
No, but just rapping, man.
So, The Art of Love.
Yes.
It's available on, I guess, on all of our digital platforms today, Spotify, iTunes,
Absolutely. And then if they want the hard disk and want an autograph, they can just go to artsherrodjrstore.com and place their order. It'll deliver right to their house. And I personally autograph everyone that leaves out.
Oh, that's nice, man.
Well, I'll make sure that information is up on our page and all of my profile and entertainment pages.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you guys very much, man. I really do.
I told you, man, you'd have made my list with, you know, the Candy Dolphins and, you know, the Kurt Whelums and the Boney James. Oh, you know, that's my new list, you know. I can't put you in the old list because them cats is way too old for you, you know. Dexter Gordon and Sonny Rollins, you know, and Lester Young, they too old to put you over there with them.
Oh. And I personally, I'm getting ready to take advantage of every one of you cats that are coming on the show. I hollered at Victor already. Victor Orlando came on. We had a good time. But, man, I'm going to be sending y'all some tracks, man. Let y'all put some noise on some noise. You know, me and Don trying to make a a new move. I just put it like that. You know, sometimes you got to make a new move to make the next move.
Wedding book.
Oh, man, I'm here, man.
Like I said, the wedding book, once it's out, it's never going out of style. It'll go out of style when they stop weddings.
Yeah, I was just going to say, unless the people going to stop getting married, it'll never go out of style.
There you go.
All righty, Art, man. We really appreciate your time, Clay.
Thank you guys so much. I appreciate you.
Listen, brother, we loved having you. And
we got to have you back, man.
My statement to you is, whenever you get ready and you want to come back, give me a call because you have an open invitation, my brother. Oh,
thank you so much. Look forward to it, man. Y'all be good. Sir. All right, man.
Take care, Art.
All right, you too. Bye-bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, family and friends, thank you for joining us right here on Inside the Music. I am your big homie, Storm E. Weathers, the Beast from the East Coast, with my brothers, KC Cousin and Don. DC DaCosta, my mentor, and this episode is always brought to you by MoveEmRadio.com, Source 3 Entertainment, Free Pharaohs Productions, Studio 204, Stormy Weathers Entertainment, and a special thank you to Total Groove Studio and Big Man Entertainment, where we think big and we do it big, for hosting me in this personal space right here, bringing it to you live like we do every month right here at MoveEmRadio.com. Holler at your big homie, he always around.